हेलो हेलो,
हेलो। हाँ, गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
गुड मॉर्निंग गुड मॉर्निंग
मॉर्निंग सर, वेलकम सर।
या थैंक्स थैंक्स थैंक्स।
गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल ऑफ यू। गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल द रेस्पेक्टेड पार्टिसिपेंट्स। आई वेलकम यू ऑल इन द डे फोर। आई वेलकम यू ऑल इन द आरटीयू टेक वेब 3 स्पॉन्सर्ड फैकल्टी डेवलपमेंट प्रोग्राम ऑन ब्लॉकचेन एंड इट्स एप्लीकेशन रनिंग फ्रॉम सेप्टेम्बर 15 टू 19 सेप्टेम्बर। It is jointly organized by Rajasthan Technical University Kota and the Department of Computer Engineering, Poonima Institute of Engineering and Technology, Jaipur. I like to welcome you all in the day 4 session 1. The session is regarding I would like to introduce our expert is Mr. Rakesh Singh, Senior Developer, HERE Mumbai. Mr. Rakesh sir have done M.Tech from Indian Institute of Information Technology, IIITM, Gwalior, and doing research from Thapar Institute Engineering. Sir has a good experience in software application designing, development, maintenance, and implementation. Sir is currently associate with the HERE Technology Mumbai. Sir has the proficiency in the managing end-to-end development of the software product projects from inception, requirement specification, planning, designing, implementation, configuring, documenting, closing, cross-culture team. Sir, working as a developer, which is the primarily based on the Java, J2EE, the AngularJS, Android SDK, Code Ignifier, PHP, OpenCart, Kali OS, Grail, Information Security, Python, Scala. Sir has a great industrial knowledge. Sir also have taken one session previously. I welcome sir. Please start your session and please share your precious knowledge with sir.
Thanks, Raki ma'am, and a humble request to all of us. You can call me Rakesh. So I am also learning something.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah,
yes, sir.
Thank you. So.
Yes,
I
I'm
yeah yeah
stopping this presentation. Yes, sir.
Let me share. So let me know when you are able to see the screen.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. It is visible, sir. Properly visible, sir.
Okay. So I was looking into this sessions and
sir,
I've been.
If you can make it full screen,
full screen.
It's more better.
Is it clear now?
Yes, it is clear, sir.
Okay, so thanks a lot for considering me, and very very good morning to all of you.
Good
so,
morning, sir.
So you can call me Rakesh. It's not.
Yes, sir. Rakesh, sir.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah. So, so I was just within. I want to ask, like, what are the topics have been covered, and what is the expectation from, like, what do you want anything specific to be understand, or do you want me to go through by my regular topics? So, if you have anything specific to discuss, we can discuss that thing. Else, if not, then I would be like going through my topics like public private key and digital signature, and I would be going with much detail about the research ideas and how I came up with a new technique, or maybe call as proof of experience, that I may discuss. So considering like this is a faculty development program, I believe you going into this detail of public private key and development would is it needed, or maybe you need some other topic to discuss, then you may share your thoughts.
Sir, this is great topics, and we need to learn regarding this also, that this is a signature, really very important topic. You can please continue, sir.
Okay,
you,
okay,
sir.
Okay, fine. So, okay, considering this thing, I would like you in the blockchain domain, I believe we have considered lots of subtopics and topics, but the major crux of blockchain, as we know, is about the double spending and the way the data is stored in the database. but the power of blockchain comes from the basic concept of cryptography, and that is nothing but public private key and the digital signature. Public private key is, I believe everyone is aware of it, so I would be like trying to give the crux from the topic. So this is something, a mathematical combination of key, which when combined nullify each other. That means once I have a private key, and if I have a public key, and if I do something with private key, and if I want to get that something, I just need to do the inverse of private key, that would be the public key. So this could be achieved by any technique. There are multiple ways to have the combination of private and public key. And as you would be aware of, there are multiple and lots of algorithms. Diffie-Hellman, RSA are the algorithms which are like used a lot. Diffie-Hellman is mostly used in onion routing protocols, and RSA is considered to be the father of all cryptography, I would say, because it is being used in majority of applications. So considering blockchain, RSA is an important one. So today I would be like trying to give you the glimpse of how, from a practical point of view, this private and public key is being generated. And as a programmer, as a developer, as an application developer, how we are unaware of the algorithm, all we have to do is call the APIs call. So I would be giving you a small brief introduction about that thing. And the idea behind this was to verify the data shared by the correct person. So as we all know that in the practical world, we all are being defined by our unique thumbprint, or maybe call as a signature. But in the virtual world, we need to have something equivalent to that. And to get that equivalent, we came up with this idea of keys. And say, for example, I am Rakesh, and in the virtual world, who defines Rakesh? So this would be done using a key which is totally unique to me, and nobody else in the whole world, irrespective by theoretical, irrespective of any number of people or any number of nodes, would be having a unique key allocated to everyone. So this is the basic idea behind this. We can think of any mathematical combination, any matrix transformation, anything we can come up to get this combination. So the private key is not known and the public is globally shared. Yeah, this is very important thing, because as you are aware, like so if you go into any bank, like if you are aware of the locker system, a locker is having two keys. When you go inside that thing, that one key would be your private key, and that that manager would be having a key. When both are combined, then only you are able to open the locker. So similarly, this is some sort of abstraction taken from that idea. And the idea was that if anyone is using its private key and is trying to share the data, that would be like able to, that data would be only decrypted back using the public key of that specific node. So any data which is encrypted by the private key will be theoretically unique, and hence uniquely identifying the user. I am implicitly focusing on this word theoretically, because of the fact that the technology is changing drastically. The claim to be breaking this system is being made by this quantum techniques, and we are trying to come up with a new cryptic way to define this private and public key by using the quantum qubits. So hence I have written explicitly, this is a theoretically unique technique. It can be used as to identify of the user over the internet. As stated, each and every individual in the practical world could be identified by his physical name, or maybe physical handprint or signature. In the virtual world, this could be used to identify the user or node by its identity. So this is just a rough diagram, as we are not having the board here. Can we? Okay, we do have. So this is something like this is something a user one. He has a message and he has his private key, just a black box. We are having a nullified two keys. When merged together, will give you a identity matrix. So when you are having a message And when you are having a private key, you can encrypt that message to a new message. And once that message is being shared among the internet to a different nodes or maybe users, then this message would be only able to make sense when that particular user's public key is decrypted over that thing. Irrespective of any other public key, we would not be able to get that that message. So this is a small brief diagram. So yeah, so okay, so coming to the sorry, yeah, so coming to the code perspective, what I want to, so in theoretically you would be like knowing a lot about this public and private key, but in practical world, this how this has been done is like I would be trying to show you. So let me show that thing. So can you see my screen, this coding part? Hello.
Yes sir, it is visible sir.
Yeah
the coding screen is visible sir.
Yeah, so any can ask question to me at any time, and I would love to discuss any topic if you precisely want to know. So this is like I would not go into the detail, if insisted I may, but just a briefing that how I wanted to, what I wanted to share to you is for a application developer or a person who is developing the blockchain complete module, because previously somebody asked me that who monitors the blockchain. So for him or for anyone who is curious, all I want to know is tell them is that we don't need to know the basic reality behind the cryptic language or any particular algorithm, how it works. All we need to do is like call a particular instance. So here you can understand that what I did is like I have a package which is having all the algorithm inside it. All I need to do is call the particular algorithm and define my requirement. Once done, what we have to do is, so in public and private key, what happened when you generate a key using RSA to make it more accurate, that particular keys are digitally signed. And they are self-signed, and they have this specific algorithm for public key. By default, the library which I am using uses PKCS8 encoded scheme, and to get the public key, they use X509 digital scheme. So don't worry about that stuff. All we have to know is that once I have that package, all I need to do either right here RSA, Diffie-Hellman, whatever I need, and then I could get my private and public key. Once I have that private and public key, all it matters in the blockchain world is this piece of line. What it do is like, you have this message, transaction is for 50 rupees. So here I would like to take the same. So transaction, blah, blah things, whatever it is. And then what happened? You encrypt that message using a public key. So for example, you can do both. Either you can encrypt using a private or public key. So I have taken example here. So when you encrypt that message, all you need to do is use the private key to get your data back. So when you run this piece of code, you can see that after encryption, this is like a useless method. You can't make sense from this wording. And once you decrypt, you get this thing back. So a lot of people have this tendency from a developer point of view that how does the developer know what type of algorithm he has to use, what type of coding he is to implement. So from a developer point, it doesn't make any difference. All I have to do is like change this value. Once I am like, I applied this particular algorithm, I didn't found it like more efficient, or is it taking lots of time? All I have to do is like change this particular version of algorithm which is used to crypt the data. So this is like basic stuff which I wanted to share, that once you are able to generate this type of combination, and if you know about this nonce checking, all you now need is a infrastructure where a person would be able to define its transaction, and that transaction is being attached to every block. Once you have that block, then each and every transaction is being encrypted using a particular private key of that initiated person, and then you are having this block, and this block is verified using this proof of work concept, using this nonce technique. And once if every node on the blockchain, node on the your particular application is satisfied, then it adds that particular block to its network, and hence everyone in the domain would be having that node, and they can come up with a unique chain which would say that yes, this particular transaction happened at this particular time. Now when we talk about time, you would be aware that yes, I have not considered time here anywhere. So this is very important factor, because at any interval of time there are multiple transactions being happening. So if you are aware of this ASIC property and this oracle tendency of how it happens, it try to complete the transaction, the basic important factor of any transaction is the time. Any transaction initiated at 10 and the transaction initiated at 10.01 are like, we know that the first transaction is 10 and the second transaction is 10.01. Though it come at like reverse order, maybe the transaction initiated at 10.01 is coming at 10.03 and the transaction initiated at 10.00 is coming at 10.04. So we know that yes, 10.001 was 0 was the first one. So this is being taken care inside your application. So the person who create this complete blockchain network should be aware of this transaction management system, or it can use some libraries or APIs which do the things for him on behalf of this management. So coming to the topic, so if you have any doubt regarding the same, we can discuss it or we can go ahead. So considering this thing, digital signature, so we would be taking the questions after this sets of public and private key and digital signature, and then I would be trying to discuss about the main concept. So when you cover all the blockchain concepts and when you come up to the place where you want to know how we should come up with different ideas and what could be the way to identify the problem statement. So that would be discussed by me after this two topics. So digital signature. So I talked about the time things, how the transactions are being separated using the timestamp. So digital signature problem statement is very simple. How to make the file authenticate and tamper-proof. So when you sign any document, you make sure that this document is being, in the practical world, when you sign any document, you make sure that this document is not being tampered and this is being authenticated by a particular person. This is being done using our mathematical model, the hash, the private key. That's all. All we need is the hash and the private key. So hash may confirm that this document is not being tampered. As you know, any change in a little bit of a document will change the hash. So we can confirm, yes, a document is being not tampered. And once it is been signed by a private key of a particular person, then we are damn sure that this document is being not tampered and is being given by an authenticate person. So this is just a simple glimpse of digital signature. So we can see this can be done using the technique called digital, where the file is hashed and signed with a private key. Tampering is preserved by attaching hash in the signed element, and hence any change in the file will change the hash and the tampering can be easily detected. So the main challenge, the main thing about the blockchain is the nonce, and then we are talking about the keys, and the very important thing is about the timestamp. So once you are having the, so I have given you this visual representation of the theoretical concept of digital signature. So it is like very simple. So you are having this hash algorithm. It converts this particular data into the hashing bits. And then when you encrypt this complete data with a private key, once you are having this information, though it is visible visibly available to all the nodes in the blockchain. Nobody can tamper it. That's the beauty of digital signature. So what happened is, like, everyone knows this. Yes, in the particular block, we are having 5 transactions or a 6 transaction, and anyone cannot change it and cannot tamper it easily. So this is the scope. If you want to get back your particular information, this is a reverse pattern you have to try. So the important concept in digital document is timestamp. So this is the very, very important concept regarding the blockchain, where we are able to differentiate the transaction in a pool of blocks. So like in a block, there are multiple transactions, and how we should make sure which transaction was first and which transaction was second. So this is being done by using a timestamp in a digital document. So this is a timestamp is nothing but a Unix epoch value. So have you heard about this term, Unix epoch value? Anyone? Hello? Hello? Am I, like, I am in the call or I am out of the call? Hello?
You are in the call,
oh,
sir.
Thank you. So, yeah, it would be very, because you all are like expert in your own domain, and it would be very helpful that we can learn from each other. So, that would be, so I was just, so Unix epoch value. So these are nothing but a number. So this, as you can see, this number is basically represented in the terms of time. So these are Unix epoch value. So this is just blind a number. So this is the Unix epoch value, which is being attached to the digital document. And once we are having that document, we can clearly say that yes, 15996244437 and 15996244438. We know, yes, the 81 is the latest time and the 37 is a previous time. So this is the idea about this timestamp technique. So yeah. So the point is that we can tell when the document was shared and who has signed the digital in the digital world. So basically, the digital signature is the same concept where we I discussed this diagram, but the beauty lies in this specific timestamp technique, where this particular hash is rehashed using the timestamp. So you, when you can see this 20, 10, 8, 22, 7, this is the particular time of the transaction done. And basically, in practical, when we were trying to implement a small set of blockchain, we used to use the epoch value because we were using Unix environment. And then you can create that particular hash, and then you can do the same thing which has been done in the digital signature. So comparing the digital signature with digital signature plus time is just implementation of one more module, which is like providing you the timestamp attached to the hashed digital document, and then you create a new hash which is having the document plus hash plus timestamp value, which is providing you a new hash. So this is like a small description about the important concept used in the blockchain. If you are aware of this whole idea, then we can literally create our own small sets of blockchain. And the question that previous person asked me was, who administered the blockchain? I would say, if you are able to create this design, and if you are able to create a environment where you are, firstly, I tried with, like, anyone should try with a small set group of people. So when you try to implement that thing, then you have to consider this modules. So this is like,
sir, sir, one more.
What?
Rakesh ji, please present it, sir. PPT is not in presentation
mode. Okay.
So we are not able to see the.
Yeah, thank you.
Sir, yeah. Go to the previous diagram. I would like to ask one question over there.
Okay. Which timestamp?
Previous one.
Digital.
Digital signature. So, so he. Yes, that's one.
Yeah. The diagram or this this
diagram
software?
diagram
Okay, perfect. Yeah.
So let's consider I'm having the transaction that has been digital signed, right? So that has been sent to the network. Here the verifier is nothing but the miner, right?
Okay.
So miner is going to apply the hash algorithm and decryption key, and ultimately he will get the result in terms of a hash itself. So my question is that how the so as the result is the hash, how the miner is able to see the transaction?
Okay. So let me give you so digital signature is for particular transaction. So if you want to understand it, so I was believing that the main concept has been done. So let me give you this main important diagram. So if you can see, this is the transaction which I am talking about, and this group of transactions are being stored in the block. So basically what happened is, like, when we talk about the block, if you are aware, we talked about this double spending technique. So the whole idea is that multiple transactions are stored in the block. So each transaction is being digitally signed and is being particularly taken care that nobody can tamper it. But yes, everyone can see it. So the miner work is not about changing the transaction. The miner work is making the block more tough to crack. So coming to your question, what you asked is this: when we see about this digital signature, it is for particular transaction. And when the miner work, miner does not work on transaction. It works on blockchain. So that block, that complete block, which is having a collection of transactions. Say for example, at 10 o'clock, I would be having like 5 transactions. So this 5 transactions would be pooled in a block. And then this block would be is used, and the miner would be trying to provide a proof of work on that block and not on the particular transaction document. So this is very important concept. Many people get confused, and that is valid point. So digital signature and other stuff are to make sure that your transaction is tamper proof. But to make your block more tamper proof, we are going to implement proof of work and other things. And that is why the miner come in the picture. So did my statement make sense? Yeah. Yes. So this is like so this over all the blockchains and any stuff, I believe. So what is my thought over this thing was that if we are good with this important concept, then creating a blockchain is like not a big issue, and everyone can try it out, because the very basic idea about blockchain is the main paper, which if you are aware of. So let me give you that glimpse. Yeah. So have you seen this main paper through which everything has been derived? Anyone? Have you? So like this paper.
Yes, paper by Satoshi Nakamoto.
Yes. So this guy, Satoshi Nakamoto, this guy is like, if you read this paper in detail, it has never defined the complete process. This paper only give you the glimpse of idea. This paper says it is up to you how you implement the stuff. And when you read it like multiple times, the smart contract idea is inbuilt inside this paper. And the guy who implemented this Ethereum got an idea from this. So anyone who can look this paper, they would be trying to so if you read it multiple times, you would get an idea of pooling of contract. So I would be discussing this thing right now. So when you see this thing, the important concept here is about, he has tried to clearly define that, yes, any block which would be having multiple transactions, he says, I don't know how you implement it. That particular transaction should be uniquely and tamper-proof. And to make sure that the block is not changed, you have to come up with a new unique idea where you make everyone in the network realize that it's very costly to break the block. And any trustful node, which needs the information of block, he only can try to come up with a particular way to break that block. So when we talk about a centralized way, it is very clear that central mechanism is taking care of everything. But when we talk about peer nodes, the very important factor of trustness is at the stake. So that is being taken care by particular this proof of work. So if you want to if you want to know how the blockchain really works, I believe we should reread it multiple times. And this is the Bible for this complete blockchain and Bitcoin, blockchain and the Bitcoin idea. So this is very important paper, and I try to read it like multiple times. And each time when I read, I get a new idea out of it. So he has tried to give you the probability of like attackers finding the next block. And this is very simple mathematics. So it's not like he has provided, this is Poisson distribution. And you can easily come up with, you can understand that idea. So yeah, so coming to the topic. So what today I thought was like, I would be taking this important concept, research idea. So as a PhD student or as a blockchain researcher, there are multiple ways and multiple technicality associated to blockchain, and it is totally like changing, and there are multiple concepts coming out of the blockchain idea. But there are two types of research we can do in this field. One is directly going into the practical implementation of blockchain and trying to come up with really hard algorithm which try to solve the problem in the best optimized way. As a PhD scholar, I find that to be very tough, because there is very less chance that you would be coming up with some new cryptographic technique. So say, for example, I came up with a new technique called as guess cryptography. So that is an idea where I thought that in the coming future, there would be a possibility that obviously at certain time, your any system would be breakable once you are having that particular quantum qubits available, or if you are trying to go with a brute force and you are having a very huge infrastructure of computational power, you can all obviously solve that problem at certain time limit. But when you talk about this, so that is why I came up with this new technique called as guess cryptography, which is not yet published, but I would give you the glimpse of that idea, where the idea is very simple, that the key is being guessed, and it is like the moment your technology grow, the guessing key grow, and it becomes directly proportional to the attackers to break it down. So this is very tough to come up with a new altogether algorithmic way to find the technique to encrypt or decrypt your data. But there is another part of research which is like very I would say very much open to the research domain, where we would be like, I would be saying that we should target that thing, because that is very easy for us to implement our SCI and other papers. And that would be something which I have like tried to come up with some points, which I think according to me could be a research topic. So the first very important thing, the idea of Satoshi was to eliminate bank from centralized system. If you think from his perspective, he wanted the centralized system to be not controlled by any one people. And hence his idea was made to break the centralized system and come up with some framework, some approach where you would be able to convert a centralized system to a distributed network. So my idea would be like that, can we design a framework which could solve our all problem of centralized system, or maybe which would be like it should directly convert our centralized problem to a distributed network. So if you think this question, Can we come up with an approach framework to solve any centralized problem using a distributed network? We can always think of any problem statement which we have present in the which is been implemented in the centralized system. Say for example, this video call. As you are aware, this video call is like is being centralized by this Google Hangout, but there are some video calls which work on peer-to-peer network. So there are always an alternative for centralized problem, but we don't have any framework or maybe a steps or maybe a protocol which could define that yes, you should do like this, or then you could come up with this this approach and you can create your own distributed network out of the problem which is being handled by the centralized network. So one idea which always I think of is like whenever I get a chance of from the blockchain and from the peer-to-peer concept, whenever I see this problem as an open challenge, and I try to see any problem and try to convert it down, like healthcare, like education system. Can we come up with a solution where we don't rely on centralized system? Because we all know that dependency is on the single server. So how we can eliminate that dependency? Second question is, and this is like, these problems are open discussion, and this is like you can see a lot of ideas and lot of papers over this thing compared to the research where you are trying to create a new cryptic hold together algorithm. Then we have how to get the consensus in closed permission. This is very important topic, and I would like to say, so this is very important because I also feel when in a company we know each other, but if I want to make my decision, I want that my decision should be anonymous. How I can make that thing in this centralized, this closed permission network using peer-to-peer approach? This could be, or if you could use a centralized system, you can try it out. But when you use centralized, the idea itself dies, because centralized system knows who are the node which is connected to it. So obviously to solve this problem, you have to go to this blockchain technique or peer-to-peer technique. So this only question will make you forced to go into this peer-to-peer network. Then can we search a problem where double spending is not a major concern? So this is like, so when I was going through blockchain, I was like, why we should go for this double spending? So there was this guy yesterday who asked me a very beautiful question, like if you are having a cryptic key, why we should go for like a double spending and other things? Why we are going for this 10 minutes nonce things? So my solution to him is like, I also search this thing, and I think, can we have a scenario, can we have a problem statement where we don't need a double spending? Double spending is only needed with a transaction management system where we are having like money things. So can we have any problem statement where we don't need double spending? And if so, can we use a blockchain to implement that design? And in that case, if double spending is out of the picture, miners are out of the picture. The moment miners are out of the picture, blockchain is nothing but a data structure. And then you are having the data. All you have to come up with a design or a way which should take care of your problem statement in peer-to-peer way. So you are using a blockchain, but you are not using a double spending. So this is a beautiful way to search on the problem statement. So obviously you can search multiple problem statement according to, you can, any time you can say that I don't want to use like maybe a digital signature. So what is the way to come up with a technique where you are trying to, you can say that yes, my document is authenticated. So there are multiple ways you can implement your document in a pool of documents, and all this pool of documents are randomly given keys. Nobody knows this private keys. Nobody knows who have this document. So confuse the system. If you see, so there could be two systems. One system which is perfectly correct. Another system which is totally messed up. Once you are in the messed up system, you know, don't know. This both will work. In the messed up system, you don't know who is the right person. So a right person can have a wrong key. A wrong person can have a right key. So this is a idea which I'm currently working on. So rather than creating a blockchain with a very perfect system, why not create a blockchain with a messy system? Nobody knows who is having the keys and nobody knows what is the thing they are going to do. In that case, in fact, we will be saving our time in like identifying a particular person or doing like this. But this is open challenge. We can think about this thing. And can we minimize or maybe eliminate the block size? This is the thing which I believe majority of the research scholars or the person who go into this blockchain domain, they think from this perspective. They just think from the pure blockchain idea, and they try to eliminate the problem by trying to come up with some good algorithm or optimized technique. But I think there are multiple other branch which is like blockchain is an idea. It's not that we have to optimize that idea. We have to come up with a solution attached to this idea and maybe reinvent that idea to solve the practical problem. So this is the thing which I found a lot in, like, I would say lots of research has been done on this thing. And then we are having anonymous. So yeah, this is one example which I have tried to implement it, and I applied for patent for this idea. So these are few steps. I would try to discuss this concept. Can we search a problem where double spending is not a major concern? If so, how we will be able to practically design that complete problem? So I was thinking on that step, and I came up with this new concept called as proof of experience. And I would love to discuss this thing. Maybe you would be able to think from that perspective also. So I have this site where what I do is, like, whenever I get an idea, so I am having like 25 ideas. So the moment they get published, I try to put it here. So there is this algorithm pool, which is like I would be discussing it in personally if someone asked me. So this has been published in US, and this is the proof of experience which is relevant to our like blockchain and other stuff. So this is how I came up with this idea, was that I am working in a company, and in a company we have tasks, and so every task is being quality assured. What does this mean is, like, when a particular task is being done by a particular person, this is again being quality checked by another person. So I was thinking of a solution where I could be trying to solve this problem in like peer-to-peer network. I don't want to rely on centralized system, because the moment I rely on the centralized system, I am like forcing myself to believe on a single doctrine principle. So I was thinking of like how we can solve this problem in like peer-to-peer network, and this quality assurance, how I can make this quality assurance in the block, how I can implement this quality assurance in the blockchain. So this problem is very good, where we don't need double spending. And basically this problem was a problem which I thought of, and you can read it, as we know that manual task. So the main idea was something like this. So giving you a glimpse, this is one employee, 35451. This is another employee, 37881, because all employee has their own IDs. And then each and every employee would be solving a problem. Exceptions are a problem. So task one, task two, task three. So what happened is, like, each and every employee is expert in its own task. Somebody is good in like plotting a map. Somebody is good in like doing the statistic. Somebody is good in plotting a sign on the map. Somebody is good in plotting the poles on the map and other stuff. So what happened is, like, this is a task allocating server. What it do is, like, it distribute the task to all the employees. And once that task, which is being solved by a particular employee, is being passed to different. So one task which be shared with multiple people, and the people which is been reviewing that task are expert in their own domain. And what they do is like they would provide their information in the form of blocks. So this exception one and exception two are two blocks, two transactions, and the two transactions are having the review of two employees which are expert in their own domain. So you can see that 35451, which is saying no to the exception two, is expert in that domain. So his decision do count. So once it goes to the proof of experience server, we have some business logic that could be anything XYZ, and he can make a decision out of it, and he can say yes, this particular task which is been solved by a new person is how much correct, or whether it should be again reviewed, or it should be like pushed to the database and committed to the system. So what I did was like I came up with this CP technique. So if you can read this out, you will. So this is like a very basic white paper. When this was converted into the patent, it is like very tough to understand. I was not able to understand the paper itself. So if you are interested, we can just think over this thing. And after that, I was like, I worked on this consensus anonymously. So this is also related to blockchain. And this is also one of the problem statements which don't need double spending. So my whole idea is that we can always try to think of this research technique, and we could always come up with any of the problem statement and try to come up with a solution, and that would be very helpful to like providing any SCI papers or patent or other stuff. So this is like a small glimpse of what I was like. If you insist, then I can go much in detail, but I would love if anyone want to like ask any questions or want to discuss it in much detail about any topics. So I have tried to wind it as fast as I can, because of the fact that I think I don't know how many people are interested in this stuff. So that is why I finished it fastly. So if you have any question, you can ask me. So currently I have like few ideas, like I am working on few of them, and I would love to collaborate and discuss about it. So this is my contact details if you need.
Rakesh, I have a question. Can I ask now?
Yeah, sure.
This is regarding some research idea even I have in my mind. Okay, you need to certify whether it is valid or not.
Sure.
We are actually, we have seen decentralization model, and we are into, centralized model, and we are into now decentralization techniques or technology.
Yes.
And the main thing theoretically, I believe, is practically, I would have asked somebody who purchased a Bitcoin and made a transaction, but unfortunately, I couldn't do that. So how much delay it happens to a transaction to get committed? Because
your voice is breaking. So can you speak from the point
is it
where
clear
your...
now, sir?
Yeah.
See, the moment we execute a transaction, it gets into a mempool. Then again, during the mining process, miner will select the transactions, and the moment block is added to the chain, the transactions are entered. Then only the transaction is said to be complete or committed. So it looks like, you know, compared with the centralized model, this decentralization has a delay. Okay, in transaction. So can this be taken up as a research idea and be addressed?
So what is your good name, sir?
My name is Subramaniam.
Okay, Subramaniam sir, I would just try to tell you anything if possible, but what I would say is that rather than going into the optimizing the present technique, what I believe is like, why not go in the applied version of the present technique? So what does this mean is like, when you say that obviously you are having we know that this decentralizing is always slower than the centralized one, we know that thing, and there are multiple things which is going on, and until and unless technology doesn't change, we would be not able to optimize it to the perfect value due to the fact that our technology itself has a limitation. So when we talk about the peer-to-peer network, it is not about only the PC which is computing the stuff. It is about the network delays. For each and every packets, we have to have MTUs, and each and every packet is having its destination and IP address. So we at the certain level, we can optimize the application. But at the network level, there is always this glitches of like network latency and other stuff, which is not available in the centralized system compared to the peer-to-peer network. There is always a sync issue. There is always the optimization of the blocks issue. So your approach is 100% correct. But if I am like, I have given this challenge, what I would be preferring, would be doing is like, I would be trying to see like, what are the applications and what is the application I am going to target? Maybe a healthcare domain, maybe a educational domain, and on that domain I would be seeing what are the person using it. So blockchain doesn't say if anyone is using blockchain, he should be technically strong to like understand the concept. So how we can make sure that the blockchain is available for the person who are from healthcare domain, who are from education domain, and who are like not so technically strong, how we can optimize for them. We don't need complete peer-to-peer picture. We may use some combination of centralized and some combination of peer-to-peer idea. A beautiful approach would be, which is like I was currently discussing with my friends, would be like, when we say peer-to-peer network, we are always thinking of one node. But think about this. What about I say that five nodes are one node, and that five nodes are centrally controlled. So if I am having 100 users, I make a cluster of 5555 users, and these 5 users are controlled centrally. But the other 5 are been communicating using a distribute technique. So this is also a blockchain idea. This could be also used, and this would be much, much, much efficient if we go for like 100 nodes. In this case, we would be going for like just 25 nodes. But these 25 nodes are cluster of individual centralized servers. So what I mean to say is that when we try to mix the things, we would be coming up with the optimized technique, because of the fact that the technology is not yet developed to handle the blockchains completely. This is the very this is the practical glitch from the blockchain. That is why people are going to Ethereum and the Hyperledger Fabric, but they are not basically a true peer-to-peer network. They are basically a mixture of this thing. So obviously, we can always explore it in much detail, but I would prefer that target from the applied version, then it would be very, very easy to like come up with a solution. Hope I am like, I did some. Hi, Subramanji. Was I like clear? Or this does it make?
Yes, Rakesh, I'm here. But only thing is, a major difference I observed is today in bank, if I do IMPS, it is instantaneous, whereas in Bitcoin, it takes time because of the architectural, you know, design itself.
Yeah, it's very, very common sense. Like, Subramanianji, if you see, we are talking about like individual person sitting on the network, and everyone is crying loudly, I have done it. Now we have to consider all of them, and then we have to see who is the genuine person. This all take time compared to the centralized system, where we are like a single person is asking who, okay, you have done it, okay, done. But that is like a direct question. Here we are having a lots of layers. So obviously, but yes, the moment we would be like the claim of quantum bits and other stuff is like they can solve it like parallelly. In that case, Bitcoin will boom. But I don't know when this would happen. But what I understood from this blockchain and Bitcoin, I may be wrong, but I understood that in this practical world, we have to mix both centralized and peer-to-peer network to come up with some solution which uses the power of blockchain. And one more thing, not every problem can be solved using the blockchain and would be best to solve it. So like some of the problem needs the centralized system, and because of the infrastructure we have, like it's very simple thing. If I open a site and it takes like 2 minutes to come, 2 minutes to load it, then I would prefer that, oh, forget it. I will not try to use that site. We need a solution which is fast. We need a solution which is easy. And we need a very important thing, that's a solution which is understandable. So if many people are, actually my lots of friends invest in Bitcoin and other cryptocurrency, but the very important idea that there is no physical currency. It has been done using a virtual concept. And if you don't have something physical, how you can invest on that thing with the physical money you have? So that's a lot of basic ideas, and I believe blockchain is very open to everything. So that's a simple thing.
Thank you, Rakesh. It's very clear now.
Thanks.
I have one question. Once the key pair is generated, private key and public key, now I have to distribute among the users. So how we distribute in Java?
Okay, so if you can see this thing, so I will show you. This is the public and private key. Okay, so what happened is, like, I have shown you that in this machine how you are creating your public and private key. But when you are in the node in the blockchain network, what happened is, like, the application which has been using your machine would be creating this public and private key on behalf of you. So generally the good way is, like, so if you are heard about this keygen, have you heard about this keygen?
Yes.
So keygen is a tool basically which is being used by application, generally majority of the application, to generate the private and public key. So what happens is, like, so when you use a particular blockchain network and a blockchain application, the application on behalf of you try to create the key. So once, like, your application is installed on like 5 computers, so there are 5 Java instances running on the JVM. So what happens is, like, the particular program which is generating a key is generating 5 different keys. So say, for example, 5 people are sitting together and 5 are having their own private and public key. All I have to do is, like, this thing. Once you have this message, when it is been encrypted using the private key of one of the thread running on the JVM, all I have to know is simply register the nodes which are practically available online. This could be done by simply listening a port, opening a port like a server. So once you have a port open which is continuously listening, everyone is pinging to that particular port, and everyone knows that yes, currently 5 nodes are online, just like similar to BitTorrent. Once you you know this information, we can share that data among themselves and discuss about the thing. So this is like in a peer-to-peer, in compared to centralized, where everyone is sharing their data from a centralized server. In the peer-to-peer, we need to open a particular port, and everyone should aware that from this port we are going to discuss. So once you are having this 5 PCs, 5 threads, all they need to know is, like, yes, at port number 55004, we are going to get the next steps, next what is called as next process, what we have to do. So once you are having all this thing available, they can communicate, they can share their data, they can share their key, and hence they can share their blocks. So if you see the BitTorrent design, this is nothing done by using the seeds. So seeds are nothing but what they happen, they have a particular port open, just like a server. When we see when we say google.com, we know this thing, right? When we say here Google, google.com, we always know that this is working on 80. But what happened is like Google, browser on behalf of us attach that particular port and share it to this. So if I say 8888, what happened? This will not open. So something like this. So similarly, what happened when we talk about the blockchain? Where is this? So when we talk about a peer-to-peer network, we need to define particular steps. Yes, on this port, we would be talking about transaction. In this port, we would be sharing the private key. Or in this port, we will be doing like this. So doing so once you are open with the channel, we can always share the information.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yeah. So something like this. I don't have my laptop, but I can see whether it is working here or not. So telnet, is it working? No, it is not working. Okay, fine. So you can always check if you are having a telnet installed. All you need to do is telnet to this particular site and the particular port. You know, yes, this port is presently working or not. Once you have that information, you can provide the particular particular request. Say, for example, for HTTP, we can say get, put, post. So we don't have to rely on the browser to do the same for us. So similarly, on the blockchain, you can define your own protocol. Yes, I need to do, if I want to get an information from a particular node, I would be saying that get me my own way of representing the information. So this can be easily done. So I don't know. Yeah. So hope I think I provided you some glimpse. Any other questions? Hello. Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes,
sir, you are audible.
Yeah. So I believe if you are like we are good to go, then I think you can always see this site. What I would share is, yeah, and I would be like uploading multiple ideas. The moment they get published, then I would be sharing it here. So currently I am working on multiple things, and I would love to collaborate with anyone who is like interested. And then, so this is my details. This is my WhatsApp number and this is my email.
Sorry, could you please copy this in chat box?
Yeah, sure.
And sir, any other website which is very useful for the participant, which can whatever you have in your presentation, we can get in deep knowledge, if you can suggest any good site.
What I would say is this very important, this main paper, Bitcoin PDF, read as much as possible. This is the main idea. And if possible, you can do like this. So I would add one more thing. You can search for this Onion Routing, Tor network. Okay. In the Tor network, you can always search for input output errors communications. He is the person, Jacob Ecolomian. He's the person who has created. So he's a very interesting guy, and he's like a hacker. And they always come up with in the talk. There are, so we all know that, like, you are aware of this hidden network, all of you. This,
yes, hidden, sir. There is a deep network.
Yeah, deep network. So this deep network is being designed and worked by this Jacob Eppleben, and he's the man behind WikiLeaks. And there are, in the Tor network, there are multiple sites which work on open source project. So if you get a chance, try to connect there, and there is this hidden wiki. From this hidden wiki, you can search it out, and then you can go to the sites of like which provide you the coding open source platform. There you can identify, you can search for input output error person, and then you can download his code. So what we do is like we discuss a lot of things over the network in the Tor. So this is something like this I'm talking about. So web. So this is what I am talking about. So this is the place. It is like it is only connected using Onion Routing Protocol, and there we would be having. I would be saying you should search for this hidden wiki. Hidden wiki, open source programs. Then there are a lot of things like which, huh? This is the list of wiki softwares, and there you can see a lot of open source program. You can contribute there. You can discuss about the ideas. They come up with a lot of them and work around it. These are the information which is not available on online. So that would be helpful. So let me share the detail. This is my detail. And I would say that if anyone is interested in understanding and collaborating with a group of people who work on this thing on Europe, I would say that search this thing. I would not share the sites here, but yes, you can always search by yourself. And you to go into all in the Tor network, we don't have this .com. We have .onion sites. We need to search there. So I was having a paper on that thing. So I worked on this. This was my paper. So we can always work around that thing. So multiple of the blockchain and quantum research are going parallelly in lots of these sites. You can work around it and search there. Any other questions? Yeah, Rakhi ma'am, you called?
No, sir. Actually,
I have there a question was not related to today's session.
Yeah.
Rakesh?
Yeah, I'm Hello? Listening. I'm listening, Subramanian.
Not related to today's session, but in general, see, we see that, okay, whenever I try to tamper, the entire, you know, local chain gets disturbed or corrupted. So, will I be thrown out of the network, peer network, or if I realize my mistake and I want to join back to the network, what should I do?
See, Subramanian, I am telling, Subramanian ji, if you are having your wallet, until you are having your wallet, nobody can throw you out from the blockchain network, in theoretical. But if you go into the permission-based network, that is maybe Ethereum or maybe Hyperledger, they can always administer and tune the network completely. They can do whatever they want. So the main idea of, so obviously if you are a part of blockchain, you would be having your own wallet, your own private key. So I would prefer that if you go into the Hyperledger fabric, then you don't have control over your way of doing the transaction, or maybe trying it out something like disturbing the network, trying to hack the system. But if you are going into the blockchain, or the Bitcoin thing, you can try everything, whatever you want. But compared to 2009 blockchain, in the 2009, I remember that at that time, the blockchain size was like 1.5 GB. But currently, I believe it is more than like 17 to 18 GB, or maybe more than that. So open, if it is not permission-based network, you can try anything out and nobody can throw you out. But if it is a permission-based, anyone can take action on that thing.
Okay.
So that is why this blockchain system is.
Okay, but my local ledger, okay, my copy of ledger got corrupted, right? So how can I continue with my action? Do I need to resync it or how is it?
So what are you using? So this is like blockchain, normal blockchain or Ethereum?
I'm actually talking from Bitcoin perspective only. My local ledger, that is nothing but a blockchain, got corrupted because of my unintentional tampering of the data. Okay, I realize it and I want to get back to the system again. Uh-huh. So is there a way to resync and correct the thing? Mm-hmm. That is the question actually.
Yes. There is always. So if so if you are having your local ledger, get corrupted, disturbed, deleted, it doesn't count in the blockchain. So what happens is, like, next time when you maybe you are using some application to do that thing. So once you have that application, all it do is like it sync automatically with the open nodes in the network, and it gives you, if you are doing the mining, automatically that complete information is loaded on your machine. So I don't know exactly which software you are using, but the software I was using in 2009, I was having this wallet based system. It was very old one. There, every time whenever we used to have a transaction, complete information, that complete 1.5 GB information, was being loaded again on my machine. So you can always do that thing. In fact, you are having this what is called as this configuration file, where you can say whether you want to resync the data from the last download, or you can always say that you need to download complete set of that ledger. And I am amazed that you are having the local, a complete copy of local ledger. That would be a very huge like amount, right? It will be in GBs, right?
Yeah,
preferably I would say that go for the Merkley account and try to just see of like top 5 or top 6 hashes from like complete different nodes. And in fact, the block, in fact, we are having an open site where you can see what is the current value of the like the added block on the chain. So you can always compare that thing and maybe take the top 5 values and see. You can modify that if you are having the expertise on the programming since then.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks. The very problem for blockchain is that if you are using any third-party software, you don't have control over it. So that is the point, I would say. And if you are very much interested, then you can you can go into the open source sites, and the blockchain complete code is been in open source. You can modify it. In fact, Ethereum is like is a good example, but I personally like the blockchain Bitcoin original idea compared to Ethereum. But in the practical world, obviously we are going for like Hyperledger and Ethereum, because in the practical, Bitcoin is not feasible once you are going like lots of people are added in the network, it collapses.
Okay.
So any other questions?
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you for
a nice session.
Thanks.
And sir, could you please share this PPT to us?
Yeah, sure. I would be sharing that thing. Yes. Yeah. Do contact with me, and I would be happy to like collaborate and learn from everyone. So thanks for considering me. It was a pleasure discussing.
Yes, sir, thank you, sir. You have provided your contact number as well as email also.
Yeah.
So participant, whenever you feel like any query regarding this particular topic, you can talk to the sir.
My area of interest is like cryptography, security, and in fact AI and machine learning also I do. So I am currently learning a lot, and I am looking for lots of ideas. So you can think of anything.
Okay. Correct, sir. We also learn along with you, with the guidance of your suggestion also. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot, sir.
Bye. Bye for now.
Thank you, sir. And participant, I like to tell you that our next session will be from 11:45 to 1:15. I'll putting the details of the next session in the chat window. Our next session is regarding the applications of the blockchain technology, and our expert speaker, Dr. Mayank Agarwal sir, the first one is speaker on the day one. The sir will take one more session that is based on the application on blockchain technology, and we will meet on 11:45 positively, and you can have some break also. You can take break, and the session will resume from 11:45. Thank you all.